The Child That Went with the Fairies
by Joseph Sheridan Le Fanu.
This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Recording by Sandra Cullum. The Child That Went with the Fairies. Eastward of the old city of Limerick, about 10 Irish miles under the range of mountains known as the Slievelim Hills, famous as having afforded Sarsfield a shelter among their rocks and hollows when he crossed them in his gallant descent upon the cannon and ammunition of King William on its way to the beleaguering army. There runs a very old and narrow road. It connects the Limerick Road to Tipperary with the old road from Limerick to Dublin, and runs by bog and pasture, hill and hollow, straw-thatched village and roofless castle, not far from 20 miles. Skirting the healthy mountains of which I have spoken, at one part it becomes singularly lonely. For more than 3 Irish miles it traverses a deserted country. A wide black bog, level as a lake, skirted with copse, spreads at the left. As you journey northward, and the long and irregular line of mountain rises at the right, clothed in heath, broken with lines of grey rock that resemble the bold and irregular outlines of fortifications, and riven with many a gully, expanding here and there into rocky and wooded glens, which open as they approach the road. A scanty pasturage on which browsed a few scattered sheep or kine skirts this solitary road for some miles, and under shelter of a hillock and of 2 or 3 great ash trees stood, not many years ago, the little thatched cabin of a widow named Mary Ryan. Poor was this widow in a land of poverty. The thatch had acquired the grey tint and sunken outlines that show how the alternations of rain and sun have told upon that perishable shelter. But whatever other dangers threatened, there was one well provided against by the care of other times. Round the cabin stood 6 mountain ashes, as the rowans, inimical to witches, are there called. On the worn planks of the door were nailed 2 horseshoes, and over the lintel and spreading along the thatch grew luxuriant patches of that ancient cure for many maladies, and prophylactic against the machinations of the evil one, the house leek. Descending into the doorway, in the chiaroscuro of the interior, when your eye grew sufficiently accustomed to that dim light, you might discover, hanging at the head of the widow's wooden-roofed bed, her beads in a vial of holy water. Here certainly were defences, and bulwarks against the intrusion of that unearthly and evil power, of whose vicinity this solitary family were constantly reminded by the outline of Lisnavora, that lonely hill-haunt of the good people, as the fairies are called euphemistically, whose strangely dome-like summit rose not 6 miles away, looking like an outwork of the long line of mountain that sweeps by it. It was at the fall of the leaf, and an autumnal sunset threw the lengthening shadow of haunted Lisnavora, close in front of the solitary little cabin, over the undulating slopes and sides of Slievelim. The birds were singing among the branches in the thinning leaves of the melancholy ash trees that grew at the roadside in front of the door. The widow's 3 younger children were playing on the road, and their voices mingled with the evening song of the birds. Their elder sister, Nell, was within the house, as their phrase is, seeing after the boiling of the potatoes for supper. Their mother had gone down to the bog to carry up a hamper of turf on her back. It is, or was at least, a charitable custom, and if not disused, long may it continue, for the wealthier people, when cutting their turf and stacking it in the bog, to make a smaller stack for the behoof of the poor, who were welcome to take from it so long as it lasted. And thus the potato pot was kept boiling, and half warm that would have been cold enough, but for that good-natured bounty through wintry months. Moll Ryan trudged up the steep Bohareen, whose banks were overgrown with thorn and brambles, and stooping under her burden, re-entered her door, where her dark-haired daughter Nell met her with a welcome and relieved her of her hamper. Moll Ryan looked round with a sigh of relief, and drying her forehead uttered the Munster ejaculation.
"Ay, Wisha, it's tired I am with it, God bless it. And where's the crathers, Nell?"
"Playing out on the road, mother. Didn't you see them and you coming up?"
"No, there was no one before me on the road," she said uneasily. "Not a soul, Nell. And why didn't you keep an eye on them?"
"Well, they're in the haggard playing there or round by the back of the house. Will I call them in?"
"Do so, good girl, in the name of God. The hens is coming home, see, and the sun was just down over Knockdoola, and I coming up."
So out ran tall, dark-haired Nell, and standing on the road, looked up and down it, but not a sign of her two little brothers, Con and Bill, or her little sister Peg, could she see. She called them, but no answer came from the little haggard, fenced with straggling bushes. She listened, but the sound of their voices was missing. Over the stile and behind the house she ran, but there all was silent and deserted. She looked down toward the bog as far as she could see, but they did not appear. Again she listened, but in vain. At first she had felt angry, but now a different feeling overcame her and she grew pale. With an undefined boding, she looked toward the heathy boss of Lisnavora, now darkening into the deepest purple against the flaming sky of sunset. Again she listened with a sinking heart and heard nothing but the farewell twitter and whistle of the birds in the bushes around. How many stories had she listened to by the winter hearth of children stolen by the fairies at nightfall in lonely places? With this fear, she knew her mother was haunted. No one in the country round gathered her little flock about her so early as this frightened widow, and no door in the seven parishes was barred so early. Sufficiently fearful as all young people in that part of the world are of such dreaded and subtle agents, Nell was even more than usually afraid of them, for her terrors were infected and redoubled by her mother's. She was looking towards Lisnavora in a trance of fear, and crossed herself again and again and whispered prayer after prayer. She was interrupted by her mother's voice on the road, calling her loudly. She answered and ran round to the front of the cabin, where she found her standing.
"And where in the world's the crathers? Did you see sight of them anywhere?" cried Mrs. Ryan as the girl came over the stile.
"Our mother, 'tis only what they're run down the road a bit. We'll see them this minute coming back. It's like goats they are, climbing here and running there, and if I had them here in my hand, maybe I wouldn't give them a hiding all round."
"May the Lord forgive you, Nell. The childer's gone. They're took, and not a soul near us. And Father Tom 3 miles away. And what'll I do? Or who's to help us this night? Oh, wirsh through, the crathers is gone."
"Whisht, mother, be easy. Don't you see them coming up?"
And then she shouted in menacing accents, waving her arm and beckoning the children, who were seen approaching on the road, which some little way off made a slight dip which had concealed them. They were approaching from the westward, and from the direction of the dreaded hill of Lisnavora. But there were only two of the children, and one of them, the little girl, was crying. Their mother and sister hurried forward to meet them, more alarmed than ever.
"Where is Billy? Where is he?" cried the mother, nearly breathless, so soon as she was within hearing.
"He's gone. They took him away, but they said he'll come back again," answered little Con with the dark brown hair.
"He's gone away with the grand ladies," blubbered the little girl.
"What ladies? Where? Oh, Liam Masthora, my darling, are you gone away at last? Where is he? Who took him? What ladies are you talking about? What way did he go?
she cried in distraction. "I couldn't see where he went, Mother. 'Twas like as if he was going to Lisnavora."
With a wild exclamation, the distracted woman ran on towards the hill alone, clapping her hands and crying aloud the name of her lost child.
Scared and horrified, Nell, not daring to follow, gazed after her and burst into tears, and the other children raised high their lamentations in shrill rivalry. Twilight was deepening. It was long past the time when they were usually barred securely within their habitation. Nell led the younger children into the cabin and made them sit down by the turf fire, while she stood in the open door, watching in great fear for the return of her mother. After a long while, they did see their mother return. She came in and sat down by the fire and cried as if her heart would break.
"Will I bar the door, Mother?" asked Nell. "I do. Didn't I lose enough this night without leaving the door open for more of yous to go? But first take and sprinkle a dust of the holy waters over you, a quishla, and bring it here till I throw a taste of it over meself and the craythers. And I wonder, Nell, you'd forget to do the like yourself, letting the craythers out so near nightfall. Come here and sit on my knees, Asthora. Come to me, Maverneen, and hold me fast in the name of God, and I'll hold you fast that none can take yous from me, and tell me all about it, and what it was, the Lord between us and harm, and how it happened and who was in it."
And the door being barred, the two children sometimes speaking together, often interrupting one another, often interrupted by their mother, managed to tell this strange story, which I had better relate connectedly and in my own language. The Widow Ryan's three children were playing, as I have said, upon the narrow old road in front of her door. Little Bill, or Liam, about 5 years old, with golden hair and large blue eyes, was a very pretty boy, with all the clear tints of healthy childhood, and that gaze of earnest simplicity which belongs not to town children of the same age. His little sister Peg, about a year older, and his brother Con, a little more than a year elder than she, made up this little group. Under the great old ash trees, whose last leaves were falling at their feet in the light of an October sunset, they were playing with the hilarity and eagerness of rustic children, clamouring together, and their faces were turned towards the west and storied hill of Lisnavora. Suddenly, a startling voice with a screech called to them from behind, ordering them to get out of the way, and turning, they saw a sight such as they never beheld before. It was a carriage drawn by four horses that were pawing and snorting in impatience as it just pulled up. The children were almost under their feet and scrambled to the side of the road next their own door. This carriage and all its appointments were old-fashioned and gorgeous, and presented to the children, who had never seen anything finer than a turf car, and once an old chaise that passed that way from Killaloe, a spectacle perfectly dazzling. Here was antique splendour. The harness and trappings were scarlet and blazing with gold. The horses were huge and snow-white, with great manes that, as they tossed and shook them in the air, seemed to stream and float sometimes longer and sometimes shorter like so much smoke. Their tails were long and tied up in bows of broad scarlet and gold ribbon. The coach itself was glowing with colours, gilded and emblazoned. There were footmen in gay liveries and three cocked hats, like the coachman's, but he had a great wig like a judge's, and their hair was frizzed out and powdered, and a long thick pigtail with a bow to it hung down the back of each. All these servants were diminutive and ludicrously out of proportion with the enormous horses of the equipage, and had sharp sallow features and small restless fiery eyes, and faces of cunning and malice that chilled the children. The little coachman was scowling and showing his white fangs under his cocked hat,
and his little blazing beads of eyes were quivering with fury in their sockets as he whirled his whip round and round over their heads till the lash of it looked like a streak of fire in the evening sun and sounded like the cry of a legion of philippouiques in the air.
"Stop the princess on the highway!" cried the coachman in a piercing treble. "Stop the princess on the highway!"
piped each footman in turn, scowling over his shoulder down on the children, and grinding his keen teeth. The children were so frightened they could only gape and turn white in their panic. But a very sweet voice from the open window of the carriage reassured them and arrested the attack of the lackeys. A beautiful and very grand-looking lady was smiling from it on them, and they all felt pleased in the strange light of that smile. "The boy with the golden hair, I think," said the lady, bending her large and wonderfully clear eyes on little Liam. The upper sides of the carriage were chiefly of glass, so that the children could see another woman inside, whom they did not like so well. This was a black woman with a wonderfully long neck, hung round with many strings of large, variously coloured beads. And on her head was a sort of turban of silk, striped with all the colours of the rainbow, and fixed in it was a golden star. This black woman had a face as thin almost as a death's head, with high cheekbones and great goggle eyes, the whites of which, as well as her wide range of teeth, showed in brilliant contrast with her skin, as she looked over the beautiful lady's shoulder and whispered something in her ear. "Yes, the boy with the golden hair, I think," repeated the lady. And her voice sounded sweet as a silver bell in the children's ears, and her smile beguiled them like the light of an enchanted lamp, as she leaned from the window with a look of ineffable fondness on the golden-haired boy with the large blue eyes, insomuch that little Billy, looking up, smiled in return with a wondering fondness. And when she stooped down and stretched her jewelled arms towards him, he stretched his little hands up, and how they touched the other children did not know, but saying, "Come and give me a kiss, my darling." She raised him, and he seemed to ascend in her small fingers as lightly as a feather, and she held him in her lap and covered him with kisses. Nothing daunted, the other children would have been only too happy to change places with their favoured little brother. There was only one thing that was unpleasant, and a little frightened them, and that was the black woman, who stood and stretched forward in the carriage as before. She gathered a rich silk and gold handkerchief that was in her fingers up to her lips, and seemed to thrust ever so much of it, fold after fold, into her capacious mouth, as they thought to smother her laughter, with which she seemed convulsed. For she was shaking and quivering, as it seemed, with suppressed merriment, but her eyes, which remained uncovered, looked angrier than they had ever seen eyes look before. But the lady was so beautiful they looked on her instead, and she continued to caress and kiss the little boy on her knee, and smiling at the other children, she held up a large russet apple in her fingers, and the carriage began to move slowly on, and with a nod inviting them to take the fruit, she dropped it on the road from the window. It rolled some way beside the wheels, they following, and then she dropped another, and then another, and so on. And the same thing happened to all, for just as either of the children who ran beside had caught the rolling apple, somehow it slipped into a hole or ran into a ditch. And looking up, they saw the lady drop another from the window, and so the chase was taken up and continued till they got, hardly knowing how far they had gone, to the old crossroads that leads to Owney. It seemed that there the horses' hooves and carriage wheels rolled up a wonderful dust, which being caught in one of those eddies that whirl the dust up into a column on the calmest day, enveloped the children for a moment, and passed whirling on towards Lisnavora. The carriage, as they fancied, driving in the centre of it, but suddenly it subsided. The straws and leaves floated to the ground, the dust dissipated itself,
but the white horses and the lackeys, the gilded carriage, the lady and their little golden-haired brother were gone. At the same moment, suddenly the upper rim of the clear-setting sun disappeared behind the hill of Nocdula, and it was twilight. Each child felt the transition like a shock, and the sight of the rounded summit of Lisnavora, now closely overhanging them, struck them with a new fear. They screamed their brother's name after him, but their cries were lost in the vacant air. At the same time, they thought they heard a hollow voice say close to them, "Go home." Looking round and seeing no one, they were scared, and hand in hand, the little girl crying wildly, and the boy white as ashes from fear, they trotted homeward at their best speed to tell, as we have seen, their strange story. Molly Ryan never more saw her darling, but something of the lost little boy was seen by his former playmates. Sometimes when their mother was away earning a trifle at haymaking, and Nelly washing the potatoes for their dinner, or beetling clothes in the little stream that flows in the hollow close by, they saw the pretty face of little Billy, peeping in archly at the door, and smiling silently at them. And as they ran to embrace him with cries of delight, he drew back, still smiling archly, and when they got out into the open day, he was gone, and they could see no trace of him anywhere. This happened often with slight variations in the circumstances of the visit. Sometimes he would peep for a longer time, sometimes for a shorter time. Sometimes his little hand would come in, and with bended finger beckon them to follow. But always he was smiling with the same arch look and wary silence, and always he was gone when they reached the door. Gradually these visits grew less and less frequent, and in about 8 months they ceased altogether, and little Billy, irretrievably lost, took rank in their memories with the dead. One wintry morning, nearly a year and a half after his disappearance, their mother having set out for Limerick soon after cockcrow to sell some fowls at the market, the little girl, lying by the side of her elder sister, who was fast asleep, just at the grey of the morning, heard the latch lifted softly, and saw little Billy enter and close the door gently after him. There was light enough to see that he was barefoot and ragged, and looked pale and famished. He went straight to the fire and cowered over the turf embers, and rubbed his hands slowly, and seemed to shiver as he gathered the smouldering turf together. The little girl clutched her sister in terror and whispered, "Waken, Nelly, waken. Here's Billy come back." Nelly slept soundly on, but the little boy, whose hands were extended close over the coals, turned and looked toward the bed, it seemed to her, in fear, and she saw the glare of the embers reflected on his thin cheek as he turned toward her. He rose and went on tiptoe quickly to the door in silence, and let himself out as softly as he had come in. After that, the little boy was never seen any more by any one of his kindred. Fairy doctors, as the dealers in the preternatural, who in such cases were called in, are termed, did all that in them lay, but in vain. Father Tom came down and tried what holier rites could do, but equally without result. So little Billy was dead to mother, brother, and sisters, but no grave received him. Others, whom affection cherished, lay in holy ground, in the old churchyard of Abington, with headstone to mark the spot over which the survivor might kneel and say a kind prayer for the peace of the departed soul. But there was no landmark to show where little Billy was hidden from their loving eyes, unless it was in the old hill of Lisnavora, that cast its long shadow at sunset before the cabin door, or that, white and filmy in the moonlight in later years, would occupy his brother's gaze as he returned from fair or market, and draw from him a sigh and a prayer for the little brother he had lost so long ago and was never to see again.